वाइल्ड ज़ेब्रा फिश। सो इन एनिमल्स ग्रुप लिविंग इज वाइडली ऑब्जर्व एंड दिस हैज सेवरल एडवांटेजेस। सो दिस इज अ पिक्चर ऑफ अ ग्रुप ऑफ एल्क्स एंड इन एल्क्स व्हेन द ग्रुप साइज इज लार्ज देर इज इंक्रीज्ड प्रेडेटर अवॉइडेंस। सो व्हेन देर आर अ लॉट ऑफ इंडिविजुअल्स द चांसेस ऑफ द प्रेडेटर विच इज अ वुल्फ अटैकिंग अ पर्टिकुलर इंडिविजुअल गोज डाउन। ग्रुप लिविंग ऑल्सो इंक्रीजेस फॉरेजिंग एफिशंसी एज सीन इन अफ्रीकन पेंगुइन्स एंड ऑल्सो ग्रुप लिविंग इम्प्रूव्स मेटिंग अपॉर्चुनिटीज। सो दिस इज अ पिक्चर ऑफ अ ब्लैक बक लेक एंड हियर वी कैन सी दैट द मेल्स आर स्टैंडिंग लाइक दिस एंड सो द फीमेल्स गो अराउंड एंड चूज अ सूटेबल मेल फॉर मीटिंग। ग्रुप लिविंग ऑल्सो इम्प्रूव्स द सर्वाइवल ऑफ ऑफ स्प्रिंग्स। सो इन सुपर्ब स्टारलिंग्स एज द ग्रुप साइज इंक्रीजेस द ऑफ स्प्रिंग्स गेट मोर केयर एंड सो द सर्वाइवल इंक्रीजेस। एंड ग्रुप्स ऑलवेज डू नॉट कॉम्प्राइज अ सिंगल स्पीशीज। सो समटाइम्स देर कैन बी ग्रुप्स कंसिस्टिंग ऑफ मोर देन वन स्पीशीज। सो दीज आर टू ओल्ड वर्ल्ड मंकी स्पीशीज एंड दे आर ऑफन फाउंड टूगेदर इन अ मिक्सड स्पीशीज ग्रुप एंड वेन दीज स्पीशीज आर टूगेदर देर इज मोर सोशल बिहेवियर एंड ऑल्सो देर इज मोर फॉरेजिंग। सो दिस इज एन एडवांटेज इन फॉर फॉर्मिंग अ मिक्सड स्पीशीज ग्रुप। बट मिक्स स्पीशीज ग्रुप ग्रुप्स कैन ऑल्सो बी डिसएडवांटेजेस एट टाइम्स। सो द फिडलर क्रैब इज सच अ एग्जाम्पल। सो दिस इज अ मेल फिडलर क्रैब एंड वी सी इट दैट इट्स वेविंग इट्स क्लॉ एंड दिस इज अ मेटिंग सिग्नल फॉर फीमेल्स। बट समटाइम्स फिडलर क्रैब्स लिव इन ग्रुप्स कंसिस्टिंग ऑफ डिफरेंट स्पीशीज एंड वॉट हैपन्स इज द फीमेल फिडलर क्रैब चूजेस अ मेल ऑफ अ डिफरेंट स्पीशीज। सो सो दिस लीड्स टू अ वेस्ट इन एनर्जी एंड देर इज नो सक्सेसफुल मीटिंग। सो हियर लिविंग इन मिक्स स्पीशीज ग्रुप इज बिकमिंग डिसएडवांटेजेस एंड सच मिक्स स्पीशीज ग्रुप्स आर फाउंड ऑल अराउंड अस। सो दिस इज अ वीडियो ऑफ अ ग्रुप कंसिस्टिंग ऑफ द कॉमन स्पैरो एंड अ मायना एंड वी कैन सी दैट बोथ द बर्ड्स आर फॉरेजिंग टूगेदर। सो इन बर्ड्स पर्टिकुलरली मिक्सड फ्लॉक्स आर वाइडली फाउंड एंड विलो टिट्स कैन आर फाउंड इन मिक्सड स्पीशीज फ्लॉक्स एंड दे कैन कंट्रोल द कोहेशन ऑफ द फ्लॉक बाय चेंजिंग इट्स कॉल। मिक्सड फ्लॉक्स आर ऑल्सो वाइडली फाउंड इन द वेस्टर्न घाट्स एंड रिसर्च हैज शोन दैट मिक्स फ्लॉक्स आर फाउंड प्राइमरली टू अवॉइड अ प्रेडिटर बट इन सम केसेस इट इज ऑल्सो फॉर्म्ड फॉर बेटर फॉरेजिंग। सो नाउ कमिंग टू फिशेस, मिक्सड शोल्स ऑफन कंप्राइज मोर देन वन स्पीशीज। सो अ शोल इज अ ग्रुप ऑफ फिश एंड हियर वी सी अ शोल ऑफ द पर्पल एंजल फिश विच इज द पर्पल फिशेस एंड द सर्जन फिश विच आर द ग्रीन विच आर द ग्रे फिशेस एंड सच शोल्स आर वेरी कॉमन इन कोरल रीफ्स। And mixed shoals are spectacular and have often been depicted in movies. So we have seen mixed shoals in the movies Finding Nemo and Finding Dory. So these are animated versions of mixed shoals, but also real clips of mixed shoals have been shown in the Netflix documentary, which was recently released. So now, moving to the freshwater system, people have studied mixed shoals comprising sticklebacks and minnows. And in nature, mixed shoals comprising these two species are found. And sticklebacks benefit from such shoals because if a predator attacks such a shoal, it will go for the minnows, because the minnows don't have the spines, but the sticklebacks have spines, and so a predator always prefers the minnow. But minnows also benefit from such shoals because it eats more food, and so if it stays with sticklebacks, the foraging is much efficient. So in Haringhatta, we observed mixed shoals comprising zebrafish, flying barbs, and white spots. So these are the zebrafish, this is a white spot, and these are flying barb individuals. So Haringhatta is a site in West Bengal, and this is the pond where we observed such a shoal. So today zebrafish is widely used as a model organism, but it has its origins in India, and it is found only in, and wild zebrafish is found only in India and the countries around India. So it all started when in 1790, a Scottish person who was trained in medicine and botany, he sailed from Britain to England, to India, and he was working with the British East India Company. And he, in India, he found some other, he found different kinds of fishes and some plant species. And he found the zebra fish and he found it beautiful. So he took it back to Britain as an aquarium fish. So he was Francis Hamilton, and in 1822 he reported zebrafish, and this is his original illustration of the zebrafish. From the 1700s to the early 1900s, zebrafish was used, was present all around the world, primarily as an aquarium fish. But in 1970, George Streisinger, in the University of Oregon, started using zebrafish as a model system to conduct research related to molecular biology. So this is a picture of two zebrafish. This is the male because it has a flattened belly, and the female, unlike the male, has a round or a curved belly. So a model organism is a non-human species that is widely studied to understand biological processes. Model organisms are often very similar to humans. So the last common ancestor between humans and zebrafish was 445 million years ago, yet the genome of these two species are very similar. And so zebrafish has been used in research on Huntington's disease, then drug screening, and so on. Zebrafish have also been taken to space in 1970. A group of scientists took 18 zebrafish to the International Space Station to study how no gravity affects muscles in zebrafish. Also, studies on behavior and ecology of this fish have provided very interesting results. And I find such studies most interesting. Wild zebrafish are found only in and around India. So for researchers, we have the For researchers in India, we can easily study the ecology of this fish. And so questions like how do zebrafish mate in the wild, evade a predator? How is the circadian rhythm in this fish? And how do zebrafish behave under stress? Such questions can be easily answered. People have also asked whether zebrafish rely equally on visual and olfactory systems. So now coming back to a previous slide, in Haringhata we observed mixed shoals, and after this we asked, so what was the habitat like? The habitat was slow moving, and these are particularly ditches and ponds adjacent to rice fields, and sometimes the habitats also have moderate vegetation. Other fishes found are Rasbora, Isomus, Aplocylus, Punteus. And in Haringhata, we saw Isomus, which is the flying barb, and Aplocylus, which is commonly called as the white spot, with zebrafish. Apart from the other small fishes, predators like Channa and Mandus are also found in the same habitat. And aerial predator like kingfishers are also present. So after finding the zebrafish, after spotting mixed shoals of zebrafish, we collected the shoals and we brought the shoals into the lab. So this is how we keep shoals in the lab. And each tank has fishes from a different area. And this is a mixed shoal comprising the different species. These are the zebrafish, and the slightly bigger ones are flying barbs, and this is a white spot. So after observing mixed shoals in the wild, we wanted to ask, why is there mixed species shoaling among zebrafish? For that, we had to conduct some experiments, but before starting experiments, we first examined the similarities and differences across the species. So we saw that all the three species are found in the surface or middle part of the water column. After checking for similarities, we checked whether there are differences, and we saw that flying barbs and white spots are significantly longer than zebrafish. Next, we also wanted to check how the metabolism is in the different species. For this, we calculated the amount of oxygen each species is consuming in 1 hour. So if a species is consuming more oxygen, it would mean that it is using up the oxygen quickly. So the metabolic rate is higher. And we saw that white spots consume significantly more oxygen than zebrafish. So now I would start my experiments. So I thought that mixed shoaling could be because of improved foraging. So out of the three species, if one species is eating most of the food, the other two species might get less food, but this would be beneficial for one of the species. And mixed species shoaling can also be because of predator avoidance. So first I conducted experiments to check whether improved foraging is driving mixed shoaling in zebrafish. So what did we do? So I had a tank where I put a shoal. So I had four kinds of shoals, shoals comprising just zebrafish, shoals comprising flying barbs, white spots, and mixed shoals comprising all the three species together. After this, I added worms, and I recorded this for 10 minutes, and I checked the time taken to consume 30 worms. So this is a clip of my experiment. So here I can see that the fishes are eating the worms. So this is the white spot, and the longer fish and these slender long fishes are flying barbs, and the smaller fishes are the zebrafish. So what did we find? We found that white spots eat food significantly quicker compared to the other two species. We expected this because white spots are larger than the other two species, and also they have a higher metabolic rate. Next, in the shoals that comprised all the three species, we checked which individual is eating how much. And we saw that there was no difference in food consumed per individual of a species. So despite difference in feeding time, food is equally shared in mixed species shoals. And so this is probably a driver towards mixed shoaling in zebrafish. Next, I wanted to check whether zebrafish are forming shoals to mixed shoals to escape a predator. So I thought that if a predator has a preference for a particular species, the other species will not be eaten if it associates with the predator's preference. And so I had to conduct experiments to check that. So what did we do? I had a tank like this, and then I divided it into three zones. The end compartments would contain the stimulus shoals, and I marked an association zone here. So if a fish cross was in the association zone, I would consider it associating with this stimulus shoal. So after this, I put in the predator, and I also put in the stimulus shoals. So one shoal would comprise just zebrafish, and the other shoal would be a mixed species shoal. And I would randomize the sites occupied by these shoals. After this, I released a test fish, and I checked which shoal it's associating to. And I recorded this for 10 minutes. And from the video, I calculated the association times. So this is a video. So this is the mixed shoal, and this is the single species shoal. Here is the predator. And I can see that the test fish is associating with the mixed shoal. So after analyzing 30 such videos for 30 test fish, and I also repeated the same experiment without a predator. So after analyzing 60 such videos, I saw that when a predator is present, test fishes associate with the mixed shoal. So what does it all mean? So I saw in a mixed shoal, there is food sharing amongst the species, and each species is getting equal amount of food. And I thought, so this is probably a driver towards mixed shoaling. Also, individuals are spending more time with the mixed shoal in presence of a predator. So we speculate that this is because the other two species flying barbs and white spots are significantly larger than zebrafish, and so for a predator it would get more energy by consuming these two fishes. Also, these fishes swim slower than zebrafish, so catching them would also be easier. So in terms of energy, it would be more sensible for a predator to consume these two species. So thus we can say food sharing and spending more time with the mixed shoal in presence of a predator drives mixed shoaling in zebrafish. But apart from these two points, there can be a variety of other factors like familiarity and the lack of conspecifics, and also many other factors like how the other species benefit from mixed shoaling. So I have done experiments to check how familiarity to other species drives mixed shoaling. So I thought that if individual zebrafish are familiar to the other species, they would not mind to shoal with them. And also, they would also want to shoal with different species if there are fewer members of their own species. So I have done experiments to check these two, but due to shortage of time, I'm not presenting these results. I would like to thank my supervisor for her help and guidance, past and present lab members for inputs regarding my work, Wilson College Nature Club for inviting me to give this talk, and ICER Kolkata for funding. Thank you.
Hi, this is Soham, and on the behalf of Nature Club, Wilson College Nature Club, I would like to extend a vote of thanks to Ms. Ishani Mukherjee, graced her with her presence and talked about why do the zebra fish have why do the why is there a presence of mixed shoaling in zebra fish. It was an informative talk and enlightening actually, because I didn't know about mixed shoaling at all. And also you talked about My Octopus Teacher, which is like one of my favorite documentaries. So I recommend everyone who's in the meet to please watch it. It's like really heartfelt. Rarely documentaries are made which are heartfelt. So I would like to recommend that to everyone. So thank you, Ishani. And I would also like to thank the Zoology and Microbiology department who have helped us with the participants for the activities. And a final thanks to all the audience who have joined us today for the talk. The winners of all the activities will be announced tomorrow. So please make sure that you will be joining us tomorrow. And yeah, this concludes the second day of our wildlife week. Thank you for joining.
Oh, can I ask questions?
Oh yes, you can definitely ask questions. Yeah.
Okay. So from what I saw, have you considered that the predator you used was a chana, right? A snake head. From the
Yes.
image at least we can see the punctata maybe. And
Yes, it is a Channa
yeah.
punctatus.
So the predators that you had, the Nandis are leaf fish and channa, they are both stalking predators, number one, and number two, they are both nocturnal predators, right?
Yes.
And you have zebra danios and you have panchaks and all, which are diurnal. At night they
Yes.
get very sluggish, lethargic. They fall asleep basically. So how would that be helping them anyways? Because we are looking at a fish that's anyways hunting at night. And you can't, from your tanks at least, you can't see that there's any rocks or there's any hardscape basically. Correct? So the fish don't
Yes.
have space to hide when they're sleeping, when the fish is actually attacking, when the fish is actually hungry. And channas don't eat every day, obviously, they eat every few days. So that's my
Yes.
question. How can you say that it's only for escaping predators and the predators themselves are nocturnal?
Yes. In my experiment setup, the fishes were aware that there was a predator, and so they were alert
No, that
because
is the thing. That is the thing. In the wild, they're not, never aware there's a predator, right? Because it's at night. They cannot see. The only feeling there will be through the lateral line movements, which the channas are very good at moving slowly anyways. So
yes.
they'll never be fully aware unless it's a really young channa that's not experienced in hunting. And feeding wise also, it's you have used what, dried bloodworms, right?
Yes. No,
But
but for my predator, in our lab in the daytime also, we have seen that chanas often fall into the tanks of zebra fish and
No,
attack
no,
zebra.
they definitely jump into tanks. I've seen that happen. I have a chana myself. I've kept leaf fish in the past, but they're mainly stock predators. In domestic, in captivity, definitely they get used to that hunting in the day. But at night, that's the best way if you want to go fishing and catch chanas, which I do. That's the best way to catch it. Just go at night, and they're all over the lake. And that's all I'm saying because it's mainly a night predator when only the lateral line movements are affecting. So maybe it's only because also because of the breeding layers. Because all the fish that you have mentioned are egg scatterers, right? All
Yes.
the fish have egg scatterers. All the fry would be feeding on the same infusoria and microworms, and it will be the same thing anyway. So you have to. You can look at that also because the breeding behaviors are having the same habitat required for breeding as well as feeding, which is mainly mosquito larvae and all, because they also
Yeah.
feed on food that falls down as from up because zebra dinos are barbels. And
Yes.
so
Yeah,
breeding
so
wise
it will
also.
be interesting to see whether my results are differing if I conduct the experiment at night or something. But then I'm just interested in how the zebra fish are behaving to it. And regardless of what the chana does, zebra fish respond to its presence. And we have actually conducted experiments where I have not put a real chana, but I've just given the predator water and
Okay.
also a toy chana. And I have seen how the shoal
Definitely,
reacts
they can
to.
easily sense the chemicals with their barbels. That's not an issue.
So my question is how the fish is responding to the chana. And I want to do experiments in the future to check out how the chana is reacting to the fish.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, definitely. But see if you can add hardscape and all to the tanks also because. If the fish will have space to hide and all, then maybe you'll see different results. Because I do aquariums. I mainly do the aquarium hobby. So I've kept
Okay.
zebra dinos. I've kept the glow zebra dinos. I've kept channas. I also have a channa punctata. But check it with hardscape because the tanks that I saw were bare, right?
Yes.
Completely. Obviously, that will be easier to track stuff, but. Then you can study the breeding habits. That if you have a bigger tank, then you'll be able to keep track of the breeding habits. Then it's easy to breed zebra dinos. It's not an issue.
Okay. Yes, and another thing is for the zebra fish, like we didn't provide the zebra, there was a barrier between the chana and the zebra fish. So we didn't really want the chana to attack the zebra fish. We just wanted the zebra fish to know that there is a chana and to see how it responds to that.
Yes, but if you put plants and all, the channa will definitely hide or something. So can the zebra, then obviously you have already tested it with the channa water, then okay, then that will be fine then. That they
Then I
can
should,
at
yeah,
least.
I should do experiments where I look at how habitat complexity is also impacting these
Yeah.
things. That will add a more question. So, yeah.
Okay. Yasin, I'll come to you. Harsh Kumar has put in the chat. I think Harsh Kumar has said, I think it was based on the preference of the predator. They preferred bigger fishes to have efficiency instead of zebra fish. Hence, even if the schools are performing or schools are sleeping, zebra fish would not be preferred. Is that right, Ishani? Does that make sense?
So we conducted the experiments in the morning. So I didn't have cases where the fishes were sleeping.
Okay.
And I haven't done experiments where I look at the predator's preference yet, but I'm in the future I might want to do that.
Harsha has asked, is this shoaling behavior seen in any other ornamental fishes that we can easily observe?
Yes, most ornamental fishes shoal. I think goldfishes also form small shoals.
Okay. Are the number of fishes in the Abhishek asks, are the number of fishes in a shoal very different in nature with respect to numbers used in lab? If yes, could this give a different result in the experiments you have conducted?
So in nature, we observe shoals from ranging from 10 to 30 individuals. But in the lab, I have to restrict to 10 to 12 individuals because of lack of space. But and there are studies that show how shoaling properties change with shoal size. So that can also be looked at in zebrafish.
Okay. Yajan, you had a question?
I apologize if it sounds silly because I'm not a science student, but in your presentation, you mentioned where you measured the amount of oxygen that the fishes would consume in the tank. How did you, I'm just wondering, how would you be able to measure that?
So we put fishes in a sealed container, and with the DO meter, we checked how the oxygen in the water is going down.
And one last question, I just thought of this. What about the fry, right? Because if they're breeding in the same environment, if the fish are swimming together, won't that have a increased amount of their own fry being affected by other species? Because fish will eat anything that fits in their mouth, correct? Fish will eat anything. If it may be a herbivorous fish, even koi are known to be carnivores.
Yes. So, zebrafish eat their own.
Yeah, zebra dinos definitely eat their own eggs and babies. That's why the breeders, they keep them in the tank for only one day, let the females lay the eggs and then pull out everything. Because after that, there'll be nothing left for them to profit. But otherwise, also when they're mixing with different more species, one that would increase the chance of their own eggs being eaten.
Yes, when there are more individuals, the chances of eggs being eaten would increase. But in our lab, we are not breeding fish. We collect the fish from the wild and then we maintain them in the lab.
And that can be something you test also, because if you can, breeding them is very easy. Breeding a zebra dino is very easy. So if you manage to breed zebra dinos, then Pantax is also very easy. And then you can test them how the fry also react to a predator. Correct? If the fry themselves are shoaling with each other, and if the fry react to the predator, the fry are able, born to be able to sense that predator from birth, not by seeing or anything. That can also be another topic that you can look into. Because it's easy to breed zebra dinos. Amateurs do it in the aquarium hobby.
So zebra dinos are slightly different from the wild zebra fish which we collect, and breeding the wild fish in the lab is not that easy. Like, we have tried multiple times, we got eggs we got F1s, but we didn't get too many individuals. So unlike the aquarium fish, the wild fish behave very differently when it comes to mating.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. But that can be a point that you can look into it, because if you can manage to keep some babies alive, the babies are shoaling among themselves since birth, or is it later on once they reach adulthood?
There are papers on that, and they have find out after how many days fishes begin shoaling behavior. Exactly.
Abhishek in the chat asks, how was mixed shoaling behavior noticed in those murky waters of the pond you showed in your presentation? Was trap and release method used?
I have not recorded the mixed shoals in the wild. So far, I have just looked at mixed shoaling behavior in the lab. But this is something I'll want to do in the future. I collected the fish by dragnets from the wild and brought them to the lab.
One other fish that you can look into is Atropellus suratensis and Atropellus what do you call it? The orange skirmer, right? Maculatus. pseudoheterophilus now. So because in the wild they form mixed shoals, but during breeding behavior it's a chisler. So they protect the young. In the wild they form mixed shoals, they are supposed to show that the orange chromites feed off the larger green chromites, parasites and whatnot, which I haven't seen honestly. From the ones that I bought at least, I haven't seen it yet happen because I know parasites probably, but that is something you can see. But that is also mixed shoaling, correct? Also for mutual benefit.
Yes, yes.
And that's among chitlids, which will be more, chitlids show more behavior as compared to something like a zebra danio. A chitlid, it would need a bigger tank though, and cleaner water.
Yes, but currently I'm just interested in zebra fish and maybe later, yeah.
Abhishek in the chat asked, I was just wondering how people observe these behaviors in these murky waters. Could you briefly explain what methods are used?
So it's very difficult to observe shoals in the murky water because we can't even observe and notice all the shoal members. And shoals may always not stay on the surface layer of the water. And shoals might split and join, so it's really hard to track shoals in murky habitats. So far, I haven't been able to do this.
Okay. Also, I had one question. Like, you mentioned that fish eat their own eggs, and I've heard this many times from aquarium experts. So why do they do that? Even if they are well fed, they'll eat their eggs.
Yes, probably because the eggs are a source of protein and fishes breed in large numbers. So even if it eats some of its egg, maybe some remain. So that's...
Okay.
It's also because the zebra danios and all, they don't show any maternal care. Many other fish, if you look at labyrinth fish and you look at chitlids and all, they will show parental care. In the first few batches, the parents eat the eggs because they're inexperienced. But that is the point there, because they don't show any maternal care. You lay the eggs and then they just see it as a food source.
Yes.
Yeah, correct. So I read about this parental care and I found out that in seahorses, the males are the ones who bear the eggs and all. So that's very interesting. I would urge the audience to look into that. Any more questions from the audience? Okay, I'll assume that there are no questions. So I would have to do the vote of thanks again because I jumped the gun. So yeah, on the behalf of Wilson College Nature Club, I would like to extend a vote of thanks to Ms. Ashani Mukherjee, who graced her with our presence and talked about why there is a, who talked about the presence of mixed shoaling among zebra fish. And I would also like to thank the zoology and microbiology department who have helped us with the participants for the activities. And a final thanks to all the audience who are here with us today for the talk and participated in the Q&A. The winners for all the activities will be announced tomorrow, so please be present for that. And that concludes the second day of Wildlife Week.